copyrighted program created by the Rio Grande Oil Company.
Authority 3 calling all cars, attention all cars, broadcast 110. Keep your eyes open for a gang of safe crackers dressed as carpenters. That's all. Rolls and stuff.
Grande checks up on the many cities and counties where Rio Grande cracked gasoline is now being used for emergency cars. Here are reports from just a few of them. Berkeley, California.
You bet we're satisfied. Berkeley police and emergency cars operated more efficiently last year than ever before. A river used with the Rio Grande cracked gasoline in 1936, just as we did last year.
During the San Diego Exposition, the emergency cars of San Diego County were called upon for unusual service. They tried Rio Grande cracked gasoline, and they say,
"We enjoyed great success with Rio Grande cracked gasoline, which has efficiently powered every emergency car operated by the County of San Diego."
And confirmation comes from Oakland, California.
"We're more than satisfied with the results from using Rio Grande cracked gasoline in all Oakland emergency cars last year. This year, too, Oakland will continue to power all police cars, ambulances, fire and emergency engines with cracked gasoline."
Los Angeles renews its contract.
"We've used Rio Grande cracked gasoline in all Los Angeles police cars, ambulances, fire engines, and emergency equipment for 3 years. We see no reason to change. Los Angeles emergency cars are making better speed, have more power, and cost less per mile to run. And Rio Grande cracked gasoline is entitled to much of the credit. We just renewed the contract with the Rio Grande Oil Company for all the gasoline used by the city of Los Angeles for the fourth consecutive year."
And so come the report from city after city, county after county. For 1936, as in years past, it will still be true that
more police cars, fire engines, ambulances, motorcycles, and other emergency equipment are powered with Rio Grande cracked gasoline than any other brand.
And now we are pleased once more to present Chief James D. Davis of the Los Angeles Police Department. Chief Davis.
"Good evening, friends. In every criminal case, this department receives hundreds of tips, phone calls, and crank letters, most of which, when run down, prove to be of no help to the investigating officers. Occasionally, however, an alert citizen will prove himself to be of tremendous value by reporting a suspicious action. In the case you are about to hear, the promise of adventure led two eager boys into a maze of facts which, when investigated by members of the police department, uncovered an ingenious scheme and led to the arrest of the criminals. If all citizens were as careful to state plain facts when reporting a suspicious person or action, and less apt to exaggerate, it would be a great help in the work of stamping out crime."
Of Los Angeles stands an old house surrounded by a weed-grown garden screened by scabby eucalyptus palms. It is a mystery house, a silent house. To the children of the neighborhood, it is a haunted house. One night a year ago, the wind blew around its bleak corners out of a dark cloud that glowed dully from the reflected light of the city. The wind moaned and whined. It ruffled the dry branches of the palms. It plucked up the peeling bark of the eucalyptus and whirled it away. It nipped at the noses of two small boys taking a shortcut home past the old dark house.
"I kind of wish you hadn't taken the shortcut, Dick."
"Why?"
"Well, of course I ain't afraid. But, well, I might stuff up my new shoes on the gravel walk."
"Oh, that's the shoes of form, sir."
"Dick. Did you hear that?" "What was it? What was it?"
"I don't know. Nothing to be scared about."
"Are you scared? But you might like...
No, I don't either. Probably the wind just blew a shingle off the roof of the old house or something.
Yes, probably. Oh, you must walk a little faster.
Okay. Lady, I promised Mother I'd get home early.
What? In that window on the second floor of the old house.
A wick with a candle.
Yes, don't run so fast. Wait for me.
Well, boys, what are you going in such a hurry?
I'm going to walk for sport. Gee, I'm glad we ran into you.
Well, you didn't quite run into me, but you almost did. What's the trouble?
You just saw a witch with a candle.
A witch with a candle? Where?
In the haunted house up on the hill.
You saw a witch with a candle in the haunted house, so you run away. Oh. I thought you two fellas were Rio Grande Junior Police.
Well, we are.
Well, why didn't you investigate the matter?
Well, we're junior police, all right, but we aren't supposed to arrest witches, are we?
Well, I don't know what the officer's manual says on that, but I think you might stake out on that house up there. And if you see anything suspicious, report it to me.
Well, you see, my mother doesn't like me to stay out at night.
Oh, not at night. Just do a little detective work in the daytime, when it's nice and bright and witches are all hidden away.
Oh, sure. We will investigate it for you in the daytime.
That's fine. I'll be looking for a report now.
And a little later that same night, in another part of town, an alert radio car stopped a suspicious-looking automobile.
What are you boys doing?
We're going to what?
Going to work at 3:30 in the morning?
Sure. Can't you say we're carpenters?
Carpenters, huh? Yeah, it's funny time for carpenters to be going to work.
Yeah, well, when you see we're trying to rush through a house to one of them big jobs out in Malibu, and we'll have to get to work early. You get it?
Yeah, okay, boys, go ahead. Sure sounds goofy to me.
Okay, officer. Good morning.
That was a close one.
Wasn't close at all. What did I tell you? It's a perfect blind. Anybody think we were carpenters?
On the next morning at police headquarters, one of the officers on the safe detail reports to his superior, Lieutenant Katzenberger.
Well, Kent, another box was blown last night.
Well,
in the branch bank out in Florida.
Any line on who did it?
No, but I got a new wrinkle in face tracking to tell you about.
What's that?
They used putty instead of soap to seal in the natural before they touched the door.
Putty instead of soap?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that is a new one.
Did it work?
Did it work?
I'll say it did. Blew the vault door 15 feet.
How much did they get?
Oh, near 60 grand.
Hmm. Any fingerprints?
Not a one. No trademark but the putty.
Well, if they've got a successful modus operandi like that, they'll hit soon again. Better get out a warning to all banks. Keep a special lookout for safe trackers.
Okay, Kent. I'll do that right away.
Independently, two other law enforcement officers are conducting their own investigation. All day long, excepting for the time they're in school, Bobby and Dick, the two junior police, take out the old dark house on the hill. As twilight falls and witch time approaches, they leave their post to report to Officer Ford.
Hey, boys. You doing any detective for us today?
Oh, yes, sir. We did just like you told us. We put a safe out in the old haunted house.
Good, and what did you find?
Well, to tell you, it seems nothing happened all day. Mighty disturbing.
Oh, you mustn't feel that way, Dickie boy. But sometimes we had to stake out a joint for weeks before the case breaks. It's not a quick reduction, especially when you're staking out on witches and ghosts.
Yeah, but there's something in that house besides witches and ghosts.
Yes, what?
I forgot to tell you. This morning we staked out for a while before school started. We saw something then.
You did know. And what did you see?
We saw three carpenters go into the house.
Three carpenters, eh?
Now, what do you suppose they were going to do in the old?
But maybe it was going to make the witches' living quarters more comfortable.
Again, our scene shifts. It is early the next morning at a main intersection in Inglewood. But the patrolman on the beat was walking along the street with a late-to-bed friend.
Glad you came by, John. I'm tired talking to myself.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that Lily's walking up and down the street all night.
Yeah, it sure does.
Hey, you ought to been with me tonight, Hank. I had a case that I got down into history. Let me tell you about
it. Wait a minute, George.
Huh? What's the matter?
Well, look, there's a light in the back of the bank. Let's see what's doing back there. I just got a door. Locked, all right. Hey, that's funny.
Hey, look, George. It's some carpenter setting up a petition in the bank.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm waving to you.
Sure. Yeah, I guess they wanted to have the work done before banking hours.
Oh, sure. That must be it. They're doing a lot of hammering and storm while the customers are around, I guess, huh?
Yeah, let's ramble on. You know, George, this is the worst beat I ever had. Nothing ever happens out here.
Oh, get a carpenter to get good work.
He's going to tell he's done.
He waved back to me and walked on. Oh, he looks like dead to me, I tell you.
Is the patio all in?
Yes, Frank.
Okay. I've got to pull in the knife.
I tell you, this carpenter gag is the best one I thought of since I dressed like a brakeman and held up that train in Utah. About $10,000 that time I did. And I never got a thing on me.
Quite sure about how good you are, will you? I like being nervous when I'm pouring this stuff.
Yeah, hey, let me do it. You make me nervous.
What's the matter with me?
I want to get us all on the can.
What do you have me?
I have a finger in your rubber glove. Yeah, pour it. First thing you know, you'll be leaving your fingerprints all over the place.
Yeah. That was a close one. I'll fix it right away.
Okay. Suits old board. Not the wires around the corner, Red.
Okay.
Come on, Spike. Get out of the way of that door. I'm able to fly anyway.
Okay, I'll see you.
Better go, Red.
Okay.
Now let's clean her out before that stuff comes back up the creek.
Afternoon after school, the two junior policemen resumed their stakeout on the haunted house. Hiding in the tangled growth of what was once shrubbery, Bobby and Dick watched the mysterious house. They had brought Tuffy, Dick's mongrel of dogs, with them.
We'll never make a police dog of him. He keeps barking at every cat he sees. It's Tuffy, isn't he? Mad, is he? Is any use walking this place any longer, Dick?
Sure, why not?
Yes, I know. But it doesn't seem that anything ever happened. Except those carpenters coming in the morning.
You haven't seen them come out yet, have you?
No. But you don't expect us to stay here after dark, do you? I was the fourth day we didn't have to.
Yeah, it's the carpet quit like the fourth day. Didn't even have to start yesterday. You were sitting there. That looks suspicious.
Maybe they're working overtime.
Yeah, maybe. But if they are, I'm going to stay around till I see them leave. Why suspicious all that, Bobby? I'm pretty to see you.
You're going to stay here in the dark?
Sure, if I have to. You can stay with me, aren't
you? Yes, if I...
You're not afraid, are you?
Oh, no, I'm not afraid. Oh,
Bobby, look. Here comes the man with the watch.
Oh, Bobby. Put your hand on his car.
You want to look suspicious, didn't you say, Bobby?
Yes, I would. He looks like a robber or something. You must remember his description, Dick. American? About 25, didn't you say?
Yeah, maybe. Awful old American.
Just in a blue suit and brown shoes.
Suit is in print. His shoes in the car.
I looked it. He's got a tattoo on his right hand. That's very important.
Yeah.
He's thinking of that.
Maybe he's got his hand full of dresses.
No, he wouldn't. He don't look like that.
Bobby, look. Look, he's opening his door to let him in.
It's the old witch who saw at the window the other night.
Maybe.
Let's sneak up to the house and look in the window.
Oh, I don't know.
Are they doing?
Well,
oh, come on. It's broad daylight. We got Tuffy along with us to protect us.
Yeah. Okay, then.
Lead back over to that palm tree, and then to the next one. And then to those bushes by the window. Come on.
All right.
I'll just be quiet, Tuffy. Well, we made the first tree. Come on now, the next tree. Quiet. Look at him in the bushes. Yes. Come on over here.
Oh, there's the old witch man, Dr. Lucy.
He's hanging and fighting in the Can you hear what they're saying?
No, Kino.
No. But look, Luke. He's flipping it.
Say, I saw a picture once your father did that.
But that stuff meant his ghost.
Gee, that doesn't belong,
huh? It sure is.
Now he's giving us the money. He's giving us a party.
Gee, we better tell Mr. Forbes about this right away. Come on, let's get out of here.
What are you doing in there?
Why, we wasn't doing anything, mister.
No, that is, you see, why, we were playing ball and I missed the kitchen. I think it, that is, the ball came up here.
We were just looking for it.
Just looking for your ball, huh? I'll beat you young scamps to first pass. I'll beat you without an inch of your worthless.
Help me, you killed me.
You
killed him.
I'll kick you through, you hombre. Get off before I beat you within an inch of your life.
Come on, Bobby. We got to find shelter. We need to find someplace. Here's
Bobby.
Bobby,
here's Bobby.
So we bounced up the end of the house across the street off this point. I don't know. I'll bet he's hurt.
You saw them passing money for gold, huh?
Yeah. It all looks suspicious. But it wasn't. Why would the bank threaten to beat us up? Why would he keep nothing? We better raid them, Officer Ford.
Yeah, maybe we better. But first off, I think we better get Puppy to the hospital.
You think it? Will it be all right?
Oh, I can't say that's the key. But I guess he'll come through. Looks like he's more stiff than anything else. So we better get on to the vet and make sure.
Danger, and within a week will be as good as new. Then the two embryo officers and their uniformed friends turned to the problem of the boy's discovery. After carefully hearing their story, Forbes reports to Captain Seager of the narcotics squad. And the captain soon has Detective Chitwood and Woolman in his office.
Boys, I just got a tip on a narcotic plant over on Boyle Heights. Here's the address written on this slip of paper. Go out there and see what it's all about.
Okay, Captain.
Just hang around the place and get the lay of the land before you make any arrests. Tip came through a couple of kids, and there may not be anything to it. And again, there may.
We'll watch our steps, Cap.
All right, boys. Good luck.
Go to the old dark house on the hill, go Chitwood and Woolman. They park their police car in the shadows and quietly approach the house.
Why, this place doesn't look like it had been occupied for years, Eddie.
Oh, it sure doesn't. What's the address the cat gave us?
Windows boarded up, lawn a mess of
weeds. Quiet. Here comes somebody. Duck in these shrubs here. That's Willie Gillespie. I know him.
You mean the dope peddler?
Sure.
Looks like we're on the track of something.
It sure does.
Let's knock him over there.
Not yet. No, sir. I don't work that way. We just take our time till we know what we're after.
So hour after hour, the two officers crouch uncomfortably in the bushes, watching shadowy figure after shadowy figure enter and leave the old dark house.
Funny thing, must have been a half dozen people going in and come out of that joint, and not a sign of life inside.
Oh, they must have a joint in the cellar. Well, they've got the windows so heavily curtained, you can't tell whether there's anyone there.
This thing's beginning to get me. I want some action.
Oh, you want to walk in there and get mowed down, huh? Just wait a while. Something will happen.
Look, Eddie. At the window, huh?
Yeah. Old woman with a candle.
She looks like a witch.
Yeah, but I imagine she's flesh and bone all right.
Here comes somebody out of the house.
Call a cab, sir?
Yeah.
Hey. Taking him around the back. I wonder what the idea is.
Help! Please! Hold up! He's throwing my purse!
Come on! Get this guy in our car. Let's follow him.
Come on, buddy. You're coming with us.
Hey, what is this? Who are you?
Come on. Don't waste any
time. Help! I'm being kidnapped!
Get in there. Okay, woman, let's go.
Hey, listen. I ain't done nothing. Don't put me on the spot.
You're not being put on the spot. We're police officers.
Police officers? Well, why didn't you say so? I thought you were with that guy.
What did he do to you?
Well, I got a call for a pickup at that number, and he stepped out and got me around to the other side of the cab and said he wanted to look up a number. And he shrugged me and took my cap and drove away in my car.
There he is. Up the block there. Step on it, woman. You better get down on the floor, buddy. There may be some shooting.
Okay.
Get alongside him and try to head him off.
Right. All right. Pull over there, buddy.
Oh, yeah? Oh, so he wants to shoot it out, eh? Look out. He's going to shoot again. I'll take care of that.
Good boy, Chitwood.
You blew the gun right out of his hand.
Yeah, but he's still able to drive all right. Give him a lead. We'll shoot his tires up.
Okay.
He's out of control.
There he is. Over by that wall. He was thrown clear.
He dead?
He ought to be, after all that.
Yeah.
He isn't, though. He's still breathing.
All right, buddy. Pick him up.
What?
Up. Drop that gun.
Boy, this is one for the book.
What's so funny? I said drop that gun.
Okay, officer. I don't want to get bumped off resisting a brother officer.
Consider me talking about.
Well, if you permit me to lower my hands, I'll produce my badge. I'm Captain Chitwood. This is my partner, Lieutenant Woolman of the robbery squad of the Los Angeles Police Department.
Oh, sure. That's a good one on me. Oh, what could I know? If you fellas in 30-year-old clothes standing over a wrecked car with smoking revolvers, you look like a beast to me.
Well, let me assure you, it might have been a worse beast. If you hadn't been in uniform, we'd certainly have let you have it, too.
Yeah, but I had to draw on you.
So did this guy.
You better
call the ambulance, woman.
Right.
Oh, and tell that cab driver to come along with us. We're wanting to make out a complaint against this fella.
What's it all about, Captain Chitwood?
This fella here stole the cab from the driver in front of that old house up the street.
What are you doing up there?
We got a tip that they were peddling dope, so we staked out on it.
So my two assistants were right after all.
What do you mean?
Oh, a couple of kids in the neighborhood, Randy Chitwood. Told me some funny stories about that house up there. Oh, I detailed them to stake it out. And today they said they seen a guy buying dope in there. And a big guy comes out and kicks their dog. Well, I didn't believe the story about the dope. But I figured if there was a guy around there mean enough to kick a dog, the place would be checked. So I made a report on it.
Well, you figured right that time, Forbes. As soon as we get this guy into an ambulance, we'll go back up there with some of the men from headquarters and knock that plant over.
An hour later, Chitwood, Forbes, and Woolman, with a squad of men from headquarters, surround the old dark house on the hill. With his men posted, Chitwood and Woolman quietly approach the front door.
Have to break it in, boy. Yeah. What are you flashing here, woman?
Nothing here but old papers and boxes. How about this room to the right? That's the side of the house where we saw the old woman.
Okay, let's start.
Nobody here. Looks like they were just camping out here. A couple of cots, candles, frying pan, the fire.
Hey, look here.
What?
Huh?
Windows of course closed.
Huh. Yeah, this was a plant, all right.
Now, what do you suppose this is? More dope?
What, in a can?
Yeah, look. Dirty, sticky stuff.
Mm-mm. No, that isn't dope. That's putty.
Putty? Now, what do you suppose?
There's been several face cracking jobs recently that use putty instead of soap. I wonder.
Ransacked the old house from cellar to garret, and the results of their findings sent Lieutenant Katzenberger to the bedside of the wounded suspect in the jail ward at the hospital.
Well, Smith,
How do you feel today?
Hurts like the devil. Elbows are a lot of brave guys shooting me down like I did.
All right, Smith. No sense in being belligerent. You fired first.
Belligerent, huh? Say, listen, mister. When I get out of here, I'm going to get every one of you guys and get you in my own way.
You're not going to get out of here for a long time, Smith.
Huh? What do you mean?
Well, both your arms are broken. You're lucky there isn't a bullet in your heart. One was heading there, but the cab stopped it.
Arms will get well. I'll live for a long time.
Maybe so. But you'll be looking at the world through steel bars.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Now, are you ready to talk?
What about?
Well, first, who was living with you in that house in Boyle Heights?
So they got away, huh?
Yes, they got away. But heard the shooting and beat it.
Well, that's just fine.
Who are they?
Wouldn't you like to know?
Frankly, yes.
Well, I ain't saying, Steve. They're out in the clear, and all you got on me is swiping that cab. I'll do a stretch in the county jail, and that'll be that.
Oh, no, it won't.
Why not?
Hey, your friends were in a hurry to leave. They forgot their narcotics.
I don't know anything about that.
Maybe not. But we'll have a violation of the State Poison Act against you.
The stuff wasn't mine.
Whose was it, then?
I'll take the rap. I ain't talking to you.
I'll say you'll take the rap. Now, how about those bank robberies?
What bank robberies?
The ones where you use putty instead of soap to blow the safe.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Oh, yes, you do.
I never had no putty.
Are there any burglar's tools in a carpenter's toolbox?
No.
You were dressed in carpenter's overalls when you swiped the cab. What bank were you planning to hold up that night?
I ain't talking. You can't prove it.
I think we can. Because, you see, your friends also forgot some of their dough when they left in such a hurry. They forgot about $2,000. We find that the serial numbers of that $2,000 are the same as the money that was stolen from that bank over on Slauson the other night. Now, how about it? Well, you better talk. We got you for swiping the cab, we got you for narcotic possession, and we got you for bank robbery. And, oh, yes, we got you for kicking a dog.
For kicking a dog? Oh. So those little brats squeal, did they? A fine police force you got when you send kids out to do your work.
How about it? Who was in on those jobs with you?
I ain't talking.
We'll get them sooner or later, you know. Mugs like you can't stay out of trouble very long.
Okay. Go get them. But I won't tell you who they are. Go on, go on. Send me up. I'll take my rap. But I won't turn stooly.
Criminal psychology is a funny thing, Smith. You kick a little dog, but you won't help us catch rats.
Smith was dragged off shore as a criminal, finally gave a long and amazing confession of his crime, which included robberies in a half dozen states. But he never gave the identity of his pal. Nevertheless, the investigation goes on. I can safely say that it is only a matter of time before the other members of this outlaw gang will be in San Quentin Penitentiary, where Smith was sent for some 7 years to life.
Thank you, Captain Chitwood.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Rio Grande Oil Company invites you to get acquainted with your nearest Rio Grande dealer. He offers you a free copy of that unique monthly publication, The Calling All Cars News, full of detective stories and movie news. To you who use Rio Grande Cracked Gasoline, the dealer offers you free police money, coupons, which you can exchange for valuable gifts for boys and girls. And for you who use low-priced gasoline, Rio Grande offers you new G-Gas, the lowest-priced gasoline it's safe to buy. The first gasoline guaranteed to exceed the United States government specifications. In oil and in gasoline, Rio Grande continues the policy which has made it the fastest-growing oil company in the West. More value for your money.
Police calling all cars, attention all cars, cancellation broadcast 110.
regarding a gang of safe crackers. The leader of this gang is now in custody. That's all. Those people.